Pause the video and go through the question carefully. Okay, now we can go through the important points in this question. We can see that this question is not exactly a series of parallel capacitor problem. The one capacitor is charged initially and then used to charge a second uncharged capacitor. So the interpretation of this problem is one capacitor charging another one. The first capacitor is charged using a 6-volt battery. After disconnecting the battery, a second capacitor, 9.3 microfarad, is connected through a switch. And we are asked to find the charge on each capacitor when equilibrium is achieved. Now let's look how we can develop a strategy to solve this particular problem. First, let's draw the diagram of the first part of the question. So we have a 6-volt battery. Let me call this V0, which is 6-volt. And it's connected to a capacitor C1 for charging, which is 3.1 microfarad. As the capacitor C1 is connected to the battery, it will have 6-volt more across the plates once fully charged. Now we can find the charge on this capacitor using the equation Q equals Cv, where Q is the magnitude of the charge on each plate, C is the capacitance, and V the potential difference across the plates. Hence, our first strategy is to find the charge Q0 on the capacitor C1 when it's fully charged. So Q0 equals C1 is its capacitance, and V0 is the potential across the plates when it's fully charged. After disconnecting from the battery, this capacitor of charge Q0 is connected to a second capacitor of a different capacitance through a switch. We can draw a diagram showing the situation. So you have capacitor C1 connected to capacitor C2. And that's going through a switch. Before connecting to capacitor C2, capacitor C1 had a voltage V0 across the plates and a charge Q0 on its plates. As we close the switch, the charges from capacitor C1 will start to flow to capacitor C2. And the question is how long this process will continue. As the capacitor C1 is losing the charges as Q0 decreases, the V0, the initial potential across the plates, decreases. At the same time, the potential across the plate C2 is increasing, and the charge as the charge on the plates is increasing. And this process continues until both capacitors have the equal potential across its plates. So that means V1, potential across capacitor C1, is equal potential across C2. So the second step is to equate potential across the capacitors. So you can see that any further charge transfer is not possible as the charge is feeling equal and opposite force from the two capacitor plates. So you can see it's equilibrium. Okay, so now you have the charge Q1 on capacitor C1 and charge Q2 on capacitor C2 in equilibrium. And all the charges distributed on the two capacitors are originally from capacitor C1. Charge conservation should be applied here. As long as there's no battery present in the second configuration, there's no extra charge can be moved across the plates of any capacitor, so the sum of the charges in two capacitors should be equal to the initial charge on zero. So you can see that Q0 equals Q1 plus Q2, where Q0 is initial charge on capacitor C1 when it's connected to the battery and it's fully charged, and Q1 and Q2 are the charges on capacitor C1 and C2 in equilibrium. Now, we can use these steps and equations and evaluation steps to find the actual values of Q1 and Q2. First, the charge on the first capacitor when it's connected to the battery can be found using the equation Q0 equals C1 V0. So V0 is the battery voltage. When it's fully charged, V0 is the voltage across the capacitor plates. So that's 1 becomes 3.1 microfarad times 6 volt, giving me 18.6 microcoulomb as the charge on the first capacitor when it's fully charged and before it's connected to the second capacitor. Now we can look at the second configuration and the use of equations in steps 2 and 3 to solve the charges Q1 and Q2 on each capacitor when equilibrium is achieved. So we have from step 2, V1 equals V2, we have equation Q equals CV for the capacitor, so you can use this equation to write V1 and V2 as Q1 on C1 equals Q2 on C2. I call this equation as equation A. And from step 3, we have another equation, Q0 equals Q1 plus Q2. I call this equation as B. Now we can use these two equations to solve for Q1 and Q2 because these are two of the only unknowns in this problem. So let me first rearrange the equation B to get Q2 as Q0 minus Q1. Let me call this equation C, and we can sub this equation into A to get the solution for Q1. So Q1 on C1 equals Q2 is now Q0 minus Q1 on C2. Now I can solve this equation to get Q1. So let me rearrange by first cross multiplying the terms, which is Q1 C2 equals C1 Q0 minus Q1, and I'll expand this side, C1 Q0 minus C1 Q1, and now I have terms containing Q1 on different sides, so let me plug these terms into one side, Q1 C2 plus C1 Q1 equals C1 Q0, and as Q1 is the common term, I can pull that out, C1 plus C2 equals C1 Q0. So the next step is to get Q1 by dividing the whole equation with C1 plus C2, so it's a C1 Q0 on C1 plus C2, and now I'm ready to put the values in, which is 3.1 microfarad times 18.6 microcoulombs and divide by 3.1 microfarad plus 9.3 microfarad, and which gives me, when I multiply these things, I'll get the 57.66. I'll leave the units as such to see who's cancelling out, and that's a 12.4 microfarad. I can see that microfarad is cancelling out on both sides, and then that gives me the final answer as 4.65 microcoulombs. So that's my Q1. To get Q2, I use equation C, which is Q2 equals Q0 minus Q1, which is 8.8 18.6 microcoulomb minus 4.65 microcoulombs, giving me an answer as 13.95 microcoulomb. So now we have the solution for Q1 and Q2, the charges on each capacitor. Now let's check if the answers are making any sense. Capacitance is actually a measure of the ability to hold the charges. Here, capacitor C1 is 3 times smaller than capacitor C2. So we have this equation Q equals CV for the capacitor, and if V is constant, Q should be proportional to C. That means that the capacitor with a great capacitance, more capacitance, will hold more charges. So if we are coming to this particular situation, Q1 should be then 3 times smaller than Q2. So let me put the numbers in and see if that's correct. And 13.95 on 3, which is 4.65. So that means the Q1 is holding 3 times less charge than Q2, which makes sense as the capacitance of C1 is 3 times smaller than the capacitor C2.